Okay, thank you, Jerry. We will switch gears a bit from this point. I think from this rest of the afternoon's presentation, we're going to get a little bit more into upper layers, abstractions, more models, architectures, interfaces, at least for my presentation will be this way. So it'll be quite a bit different from the previous set of presentations on the physical layer. So I hope you can bear with me, and thank you for staying through a long day of tutorial. I hope I can keep you awake or informed during this 20 minutes or so. So I will be talking about some of the main tasks and progress of the work in the S33 ad hoc group. I would basically give you a bit more detail on what Yang Quan Lim, our S33 chair, has alluded to as this particular ad hoc group. So let's move on. Let's go on. Okay, so this slide was shown earlier today by Yang Quan, and as you can see, S33 is made up of these three ad hoc groups, S33 1, 2, and 3. I will talk about the S33 1 group, which the title of our group is on service delivery and synchronization, but we actually do much more. And the tasks that we are responsible for are to specify the delivery specifications, which does include, you can think of synchronization error recovery as really part of the delivery bundle. Those three squares should really go together. And then beyond that, service signaling, or the means to determine what is composed by a service and how to acquire them. That's part of our agenda. As well as another work area is called input formatting, and this is how higher layer packets get mapped into the physical layer through this layer 2 protocol. And I'll cover these three aspects today. The last one on emergency alerts, as I think Rich had mentioned earlier this morning, we have not yet started work on this aspect. It is very important. I think we have a presentation later today by Jay Adrick on this, but this is something we will inherit and take work on for the rest of the summer. But something I'm not going to discuss today because our group has not had time to work on that. Okay, so I will first talk about the delivery protocol aspects of our work. And there are two main parts of that. One is a media format, and the second part is actual transfer protocol. As Yang has said earlier this morning, we've decided to use the ISO-based media file format as the streaming media format for all content, streaming content delivery over ATSC transport. And there are two families of that which are included in our current drafts or our working draft specification. We're not quite there to bring it to candidate standard form, but the first is called the MPU, the Media Processing Unit. It's a format that's defined in MPEG in the form of 23008-1. That's one of the two formats. And the other format is something you may have also have heard called DASH, Dynamic Adaptive Streaming over HTTP. And this is also MPEG specification 23009-1. As said before, there is no MPEG 2 transport stream encoded media for ATSC 3.0. We will take the ISO BMF formatted content and deliver that directly over a native IP transport protocol. And currently, our working group has settled on two options for the broadcast streaming. The first of these is the MMTP, or the MPEG Media Transport Protocol over UDP IP. This is actually part of the 23008-1 family of a protocol. So that's associated with delivery of MPUs as the payload. And the second protocol is ROOT, real-time object delivery over unicast transport. The ROOT protocol is basically an enhancement of something you may have heard of called FLUT, which is a protocol used to deliver file objects over unidirectional transport. But ROOT is designed to optimize the delivery for streaming content. So ROOT is designed to deliver DASH as the ISO BMFF, and again, MMTP designed to carry MPU. And then for broadcast file downloading, we will exclusively use the ROOT protocol to carry any type of NRT files or application-based enhancements over UDP IP. And then, of course, there's always the broadband aspect, whether it's a hybrid service or service that's only available for broadband, that will be strictly, for streaming media, will strictly be Dash carried over HTTP. Okay, I guess I don't have animation on this slide, or maybe I do. Okay, in any case, the diagram on the right is actually a protocol stack conceptual model that's come out of our working draft document. It's not complete. There are gray areas in this slide that shows some areas that we still need to finalize. But generally, this outlines the entire, you can think of the entire ATSC protocol stack from the applications all the way down to the physical layer transport. And I've basically broken this down to three main areas, the services or the application services area on top, and in the middle, the encoding, formatting, and service management, and on the bottom, the delivery. So I took liberty to actually populate a top layer on the linear and application-based services with some example of services that might be delivered over ATSC, linear TV, interactive services, so forth. Also, there are some operator management services, such as usage reporting and how to support personalization. They're not particular application services per se, but there are service enablers that's associated at the application layer. Then more of the, within the context or in the scope of S331 is that we don't define the codecs. The codecs will be described later on in the tutorial, but we take the encoded content and we place that into two different types of file formats, as mentioned, either the MPU format or the Dash format. And then the transport of that on the broadcast side for streaming content, and I highlighted that, pressed the wrong button. Is that the laser button? Anyways, you can see this dash block that shows how the MPU mapping to for delivery over MMTP. And the right-hand side, I've put a dotted box around the dash encoded format. And that could be delivered through broadcast, through the root protocol, or for the broadband delivery over HTTP. These are the main focus areas of the delivery protocol, the formatting and the actual delivery protocol itself. And then I've kind of just showed the mapping of the transport layers to the ISO model, OSI model. Anyways, hopefully this gives you a outline of the delivery protocol and where that stands in the overall stack picture. No, okay, there is animation. Okay, the next slide, really, now I'm gonna get to the media formats and the delivery protocols for the root dash as well as the MPU MMTP. Let's first talk about the root dash family. This is the streaming protocol for delivery of MPEG dash encoded media. So what is MPEG dash? Dash is about a streaming delivery model that you have a media presentation that's broken down into a sequence of segments, and each segment represents a small duration of playback, and that playback forms a longer program, which could be either a live event or a pre-recorded event. Then the content acquisition is completely controlled by a client function in the receiver called a Dash client. It uses a manifest, which describes the available components or the representations of a service. Then that is called MPD, the media presentation description. And using that manifest, the Dash client is able to request desired segments of the program over time. Although the word Dash has the H at the end, says HTTP, it is not a transport protocol, it's a format, it's media format. The HTTP actually is valid. It's actually not a misnomer because the Dash client will request content from a HTTP server. However, that server need not reside on a network. That server could actually reside in your device. So the Dash client really is agnostic about the transport. It just requests content through HTTP and it gets that either through locally or through an internet connection. The format of Dash files is shown on the bottom. Basically, you have We should actually start from the bottom and go upward. There's initialization information that is called initialization segment that has information on codec parameters or content protection type of parameters defined there to allow, which is required by the Dash client to know whether it can consume this content and how to acquire necessary initialization information, such as, let's say, licenses or rights to be able to acquire the content or process the content. Then Dash has these things called movie fragments. Movie fragments are made up of, media segments are comprises one or more movie fragments. So in this diagram here, the first media segment contains one movie fragment. A movie fragment is a MOOF box plus an MDAT box. And the second media segment, as shown here, composes two movie fragments because you see a pair of MOOF and MDAT boxes. So this, if you concatenate this content, when this gets transmitted over the air, you can store it at the receiver for, let's say, playback, if playback is allowed. Then you have a store file that's also ISO BMFF compliant, as shown by the above the arrow. Okay, now let's talk about the delivery portion of the root dash protocol. So root, again, is a real-time object delivery protocol, is agnostic to and is independent of the file's internal structure. It is enhancement or replacement of Flute as a profile, if you will, of the so-called asynchronous layered coding ALC protocol, which has been defined in the IETF. And this is the enhancement of Flute to deliver streaming services as well as non-real-time services. So the root is capable of delivering both non-real-time and real-time content over a broadcast. Some of the key features of root, a single transport for both linear TV and RT files, as well as signaling data, signaling tables. Root has something called the MDE mode, the media delivery event mode. Actually, there's a demo in the hallway. If you haven't seen it, please drop by. It's been shown. That shows how basically a segment can be played out before, or a portion of a media segment can be played out without requiring an entire segment. And that basically speeds up the channel switching or initial acquisition delay. So this is a faster startup mode of delivery that's being demonstrated. It allows flexible packetization. You can align basically the boundaries of your packets to align with access unit boundaries to get faster performance. Flute has something called FDT, which stands for the file delivery table. It's basically a set of file descriptors that may say what is the content, how long is it, how is it encoded, so forth. That information, if you think about it for delivery as a streaming protocol, you may just have the same type of encoding. Each segment might be incremented by one in terms of your URL URL for that segment. So all these type of encoding structures are really unnecessary to be sent every time for in band when you deliver that, as it's typically done, as it isn't done in Flute. So root offers this mode of sending these metadata or the file descriptions out of band in advance, and that will save overhead in terms of not having to send that in band with the media for every packet or with every segment, as well as it increases the reliability because you can send that information out of band and get it. Any error recovery to be performed on it earlier rather than kind of waiting for that error recovery to take place when the file is sent along with the metadata. So root is also very similar to, and it's based on a 3GPP cellular broadcast standard called MBMS and how the download delivery is used there. Okay, and let's now move to the other protocol family, the root, the MMTP protocol, which delivers a ISO BMF format called MPU. MPU is also defined as in the MPEG H part 1, the 23008-1 MMT standard. It is also a ISO BMF compliant file with a particular brand called the MPUF. A brand basically is a label for a conformance point. Basically tells the what kind of capabilities it has to meet to be compliant to this particular profile. And this, there's also an MPPU box that globally identifies that this particular file is a MPU file. And that allows a single media asset to be carried per MPU, let's say audio or video or captioning. The sample data are sent in decoding order, and it's a self-contained structure, meaning that all the media data can be decoded without any further information. It contains all the initialization information, any other metadata, and so forth, to allow each MPU to be played independent of any other MPU. And then also has something called a hint track to support media-aware packetization. That just means there's metadata track that allows the definition of the boundaries of a MMTP packet, and you can form those boundaries to align precisely with access unit boundaries. Again, this allows faster startup and playback because of this mode of media-aware packetization. Okay, here's the MMTP protocol that goes with MPUs. It's an alternative to Root as another broadcast streaming protocol. It's been defined in the ISO IEC 23.08-1, as mentioned, and it carries the MPU-based files. So MMTP is a protocol very similar to MPEG-2TS. It can carry multiple types of contents. One of those types is the MPU mode, and the MPU mode just means that you have carry the MPUs as the payload of this protocol. And as I said, it's similar to MPEG-2TS because the MMTP protocol can also carry other types of information, such as the signaling information, service signaling information associated with the MMT, with MPUs. So it supports multiplexing of different types of contents, MPUs, signaling messages, and even fragments of MPUs called MFU. And that's the capability of that MTP protocol to allow different type of payloads to be multiplexed together in a single MMTP transport session. MTP also defines a hypothetical buffer model to ensure buffer fullness and to basically deal with estimation of what is needed to deal with jittered delivery environments. It has UTC-based timing to remove jitter. And it should be mentioned that MTP is also part of a super high vision standard in Japan. Okay, now we're gonna switch to talk about service signaling. So what is service signaling? Well, service signaling is basically the metadata that's required to enable a device to discover what are the components of an ATSC 3.0 service and then how to acquire that information. It's basically information, it's not the same as service announcements, which Sachin talked about earlier today. Service announcement is really information for the end user, like a program guide to allow the end user to see what are the detailed content availabilities, their ratings, their genres, and so forth. This is really information, the signaling tables are information for a device, how to acquire service. The device should be able to use the signaling information to get a rough picture of what is offered as a service and be able to select that through pushing the channel up and down key or selecting a particular channel number. It may not know all the details about the service, but it should be possible to acquire service just using the service signaling information in ATSC. So it's basically control plane procedures and metadata that allows the discovery of services and how to acquire them. There's two main components to that. There's a lower level, what we call bootstrap signaling, and that's something we currently are naming it the service list table. A lot of this work is still under development, so that name may change when we get the candidate standard out, but that's the agreed or currently agreed name for this low level bootstrap information, which might provide things like what is the RF stream ID, what are major minor channels, numbers, service IDs, what type of category is that? How is the service signaling associated with that bootstrap? Is that acquired through broadcast or broadband? What are the session information to acquire the service signaling? So it's basically a startup information to allow the acquisition of the second half, which is called the service layer signaling. And that service layer signaling really does then describe what are the available content components of a service and what are the session information, such as SDP, IP addresses, port numbers, and so forth, to acquire those services. So this picture on the right is something that is also not final, and I mark it carefully as work under construction to show that there is, that the main idea is, I wish I could hide this work under construction, but there's this SLT on the middle, and there's also SLS. This is the two-step of the bootstrap information carried by the SLT, which then points to the location of the delivery channel that carries the SLS. SLS provides the more detailed session information and the content descriptions of the components that make up services delivered either through route, UDP, IP on the left side, or if the service isn't actually carried over MPMTP as MPUs, then it points to the right-hand side of the MPU delivery over MMTP. And then, as we said before, any type of non-real-time files, whether it's used as a standalone service or application-based enhancements, are also being carried over route. So the SLS will also point to any non-real-time service components through that signaling mechanism. Again, there are some areas of work to be done to complete this service signaling architecture. For example, we are still trying to identify what might be the best way to carry the service layer signaling. Should that be through route as a transport, or MMTP as a transport, or maybe directly over UDP IP without any intervening transport protocol? So these are some work that needs still to be done. But we're getting pretty close on completing the service signaling framework. Just a little bit more about service signaling. This is the data model on the right-hand side that shows there's a common set of metadata. What is a user service? User service basically is the definition of a ATSE service. Then a user service then can contain multiple components. And if the components are delivered by the MPU mode over MMTP, then you go up to the purple boxes, which are the signaling information, service signaling information, particular to MMT and MMTP. And if the service is carried over root dash, then the lower boxes in blue are relevant. There's the service transport session instance description, the MPD URI, and the MPD itself. So those are the counterparts for describing service signaling carried over root dash versus MPU, MMTP. And this data model actually has its origin from 3GPP's MBMS service announcement. It is only currently applicable or defined for linear services. So in the future, when we have NRT services over ATSC, we may have additional service metadata added to this data model, but currently our focus is enabling or completing the delivery of linear services over ATSC. So this is what it shows today, and the service signaling have two types. There are XML-based metadata fragments for delivery over route, and there are also binary tables for the service signaling over MMTP. Okay, now let's move to the third item for today's discussion, the layer two protocol. We've also been fondly calling this input formatting, although I think the word input formatting is kind of without context, it's really hard to understand what it means. But what this is really, as the picture on the right is trying to show, it's a layer two protocol that's meant to encapsulate upper layer payloads, such as IP packets that's carrying service content, or it may be IP packets or signaling tables that's carrying, that's being encapsulated in this LT protocol, or it could even be encapsulating MPIC to transport streams. But this L2 protocol will also be handling header compression. And there are actually three proposals on the table right now for this L2 protocol. One is called ATSC 3.0 Link Layer Protocol, ALP. Second one, generic stream encapsulation. The second one is a DVB defined mechanism. The third one is called TLV, type length value, and this one has a equivalent ITU standard. So these are the three protocols that's being offered, and we're actually going through the selection process for these, but This picture is a very high-level picture to show where the focus of the work in right now is defining this red block in the center, the layer 2 protocol that shows how upper layer packets can be encapsulated, fragmented, encapsulated into the layer 2 packet fields, and then in turn, those get mapped into the baseband frames, which Lachlan had mentioned. That's the job of the layer 2 protocol is to perform this fragmentation encapsulation between the layer 1 and layer 3. Okay, so we're currently, as I said, evaluating the layer 2 protocol selection. Some of the common characteristics of all three proposals is that they provide a generic packet layer to encapsulate different types of upper layer formats. They enable segmentation, concatenation, and header compression capability. And they are generally a low overhead, but they do have some quantitative differences. And for example, as points being used to evaluate the solution, we're still assessing the protocol overhead comparison between the three for the L2 layer protocol headers, as well as we're looking at the efficiency from the point of view of the compression of IP and UDP headers. And a little bit more about the IP-UDP compression, there are three different methods, and there are each of these associated with a particular one of the L2 protocol candidates. For the first one, ALP, actually two options are on the table. One is called the ROC protocol, which is based on the RFC standard. It's a well-known and well-used so that's one of the options, and there's a second option called super header compression that can generate a bit more efficiency over the ROC. The second option is in the GSE protocol, they're also proposing the use of the ROC U mode. U stands for unidirectional mode because you're only getting content delivered one way in broadcast. And the third option is TLV. They have a compression scheme called HCFB, header compression for broadcast. It's standardized in ITUR BT1869. Okay, so this work is still ongoing. We haven't quite reached the decision point on whether we take one of the three or we merge them or harmonize them. I think there is an effort to try to harmonize these proposals to take the best features of these in terms of the final solution. Okay, I think I'm getting close. We are pretty well progressing the completion of these work in S331. As you see from the timeline, the delivery protocol, the service signaling, we're expecting to wrap up the drafting work to be able to come up with a candidate spec for balloting by end of June or beginning of July. At which point we can also switch gears and put more time in focusing on the EAS, the emergency alert signaling, delivery and signaling. And then also we're expecting the input formatting or the layer 2 protocol work to complete in middle of June. And we are then towards getting a S33 family of single standard, or maybe probably more likely a set of standards, maybe one for each of these topics. For candidate standard balloting stage by July. I would say we're maybe around 70-75% done. We still have a lot of work ahead of us, but a lot of the heavy lifting on the delivery protocol and signaling, I think, are currently mainly completed. So I think we're looking pretty good there in general. And I think with that, I do have some slides on glossary, but I don't need to go through that. I open the floor for any questions.
Can you explain the intent and scope for the IP addressing? For example, are you intending to address devices or services or both? How you intend to use the addressing in this?
Okay. The IP addressing is really to identify different sessions. I don't know if I have a slide that maybe I can go. Let's just go back. Probably the close. Let me try to go to the protocol stack picture. Okay, so the main idea of the IP would be defining the different sessions that carry, for example, signaling information versus sessions that carry service data. So there may be audio component and the video component, a closed caption component of a particular service. And those components may be delivered on the same, let's say a UDP session, root session, or they could be delivered on multiple. And that could apply also in the case of MMTP, that you can have a single MMTP session or multiple. So the IP addressing is really identifying the channel that's carrying the type of components, and that gets signaled through the SLT and SLS. But they're not pointing to the service per se, they're really pointing to the channels. And it's really the information within the service signaling that identifies, well, within this particular channel, what is the content? Is it a video component of a service, or is it audio component? What is the service ID for that component, and so forth? So think of the IP information really as the identifying the transport of services rather than the services themselves. Okay, we do have this notion of, I think I may have one slide that says signaling information should certainly be carried in a very robust, maybe the most robust PLP of all. We do have some suggested rules, but I think this is much more to the deployment. But it's our belief that if you want to have a PLP that's carrying signaling, that should be a super robust PLP. That PLP could be shared with carrying other content, such as the video audio, but certainly we believe the signal information should be carried in a robust PLP, in the most robust. The detailed rules is really up to implementation on the service characteristics. You know, is it non-real-time service, so that you have a lot of time to do any, let's say, if you want to apply application layer FEC, you may say, I can give up the reliability on the PLP level, but do the recovery from application layer FEC. So there's a lot of trade-offs and considerations there. I'm not sure I'm most equipped to discuss all the trade-offs, but those are some considerations. Question? Rob?
I was just curious, I noticed on this conceptual diagram you had that there's some gray boxes wherever there's a path to actually getting broadcast content in real time to the applications layer.
Sure.
Could you speak to what needs to be done to make those boxes turn from gray to...
This actually was something we had to have a turnaround for a meeting. And I think right before the meeting, you know, we weren't able to get full agreement. I don't think it's a big hurdle of any sort. It's just maybe I should even take out the gray and not to get confused people. But for example, the area called EME and CENC, the question there is we understand, for example, that both the MPU-MMT family as well as the root-dash family will be able, because of their MPUs in dash or ISO-BMF files, they should be able to take advantage of the so-called, there's a DRM scheme that's in the industry called Common Encryption, CENC. It basically allows different DRM systems to be used to protect the same file. It's a nice methodology that's being used in the entertainment industry, Ultraviolet and DECE, and we're trying to leverage that. And the question there was the current state of the MMT protocol as specified in MPEG, is the currently available document reflecting the capabilities to use CENC? And there was some disagreement. Some people thought it would be the December version of that standard that will actually gives all the details of how to map the use of CNNC for MPUs. So that was a small area of disagreement, whether we can reflect it that way in the standard right now, or it needs to go in the future version of a standard. And I think the other gray box was about the interface between codecs and the application layer. I think there is a question of something like, I don't know if you heard about W3C has something called a encapsulated media, the media MSC, what does the S stand for? source, media source extensions. Is there a similar capability to for MPU-delivered content to be able to play in the browsers through some facility like an MSC? So those are just some disagreement areas or areas that we need to basically get full consensus to how do we show that in the diagram. Should they just be a continuity of the same color or there are some gaps? So it's something that will be addressed. It's not any major issue, I think.
With that, we need to move on. Thank you very much.